The readings for the dedication, anniversary of the dedication of the church, are respectively taken from 21st chapter of the Apocalypse, the great vision of the New Jerusalem descending from heaven, where there will be only happiness, peace, and joy. The New Jerusalem descending from heaven is none other than the Catholic Church, the body of Christ, the assembly of the faithful. The Jerusalem descending from heaven, the glorious Jerusalem, as it were, infinitely more perfect than that figure of old, that type, that symbol, is also the woman of chapter 12. You may say, I always thought that was Our Lady. That's the first point to note, the point being stressed by our Holy Father so often. Our Lady is the profile of the Church. Whatever is being realized in the New Jerusalem, that is, in the body of Christ, in our midst, and all the members of the Church now, the completion of the glory of the risen Savior, is first realized entirely in Our Lady. All the great fathers of the Church, and especially that great doctor of scholastic theology, St. Bonaventure, insist upon this point, that the glory of Our Lady in heaven is the manifestation of what that same glory now coming to be in those who truly live the profession of faith they made at baptism, truly live that new life of grace, which is everlasting life. This is what St. Paul means when he constantly insists in not only chapter 6 of the letter to the Romans, but in so many other places, in Romans, in Galatians, and elsewhere in his letters. Precisely when we share the death of Christ, when we share the cross of Christ, we die to sin. And this is the great paradox, but it's true. We begin, coming out of the waters of baptism, to live the life of the risen Savior, even now. Yes, we will still suffer. Yes, we will still die physically, but we will continue to live. And one day he will raise us from the death. He has already anticipated that in his mother, to whom he commended, to whom he entrusted, to whom he consecrated, all of us singly and together as the Church. He left us in her care. This is why she did not die immediately. And when she died, her death was different. Death was glorious. She was raised up shortly after, body and soul reunited in heaven. That is what the first reading for the Feast of the Dedication has to do with St. Paul and his explanation of the practical consequences of baptism, what baptism makes possible. Exactly what we see realized already in Our Lady. Why would anyone want to live other than according to the Spirit? Why would anyone prefer living according to the flesh? The wages of sin are death. But the reward of following Jesus, of walking the straight and narrow way, the only one that not only gets to the door, but passes through that open door of heaven. Let me come to Jericho. Reading, gospel reading for the Feast of the Dedication is taken from the Gospel according to Luke. Our Lord is in his final triumphant entry, not into the old Jerusalem, into the new Jerusalem, which St. John saw coming down from heaven in glory. As it were, completing in the Church what has already been realized in the Mother of God, the Virgin Mother, the one who stood at the foot of the cross, not because she was a sinner, but precisely because she was his mother. From the first moment of the Incarnation to the consummation of the work of the incarnate Savior, she was actively involved. And that is why through her all these graces come to us from Jesus. There was Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus represents all of us. Now, you may not think it is much of a compliment, which shows, as it were, you're thinking along with those who criticize. There he goes to enjoy the company of you know who, the biggest fraud in town, the crooked tax collector. Now, how many times have we heard criticisms of tax collectors? Well, there's something to criticize. But whether we are very charitable, though, is another matter. Anyway, Zacchaeus wanted to see Jesus. He was sincere. And when our Lord invited him to come down from the tree and entertain him in his home, he was ready. He repaid those whom he had defrauded four times over and distributed to the poor and the needy, those who were not so fortunate as to be in his position, and then followed Jesus, believed him. Because he loved him, he kept his commandments. If you love me, do what I tell you to do. That's what Our Lady said at the marriage feast of Cana. You want to see the glory of the Lord. You want more wine. You want the wine of heaven, the joy of heaven, the peace of heaven. Do whatever he tells you to do. Even if you can't see the point of filling six huge buckets, barrels, with water to the brim, what's that got to do with wine? A great deal. If the one who is preparing it is capable of working a miracle. And that's only a little miracle. We have a much greater one we are about to participate in. The transubstantiation of the bread and the wine that we offered, no longer bread and wine, body and blood of Jesus. Offered, not a new offering, the same, here and now in our place. And with the same blessings. Who eats of my flesh and drinks of my blood worthily will not die. I will raise him up on the last day. What's that will not die? I will not die the spiritual death. I may suffer, I may be nailed to the cross, but I will continue to live. Like Martha, our Lord addresses all of us. Do you believe that? Yes, Lord. I believe you are the resurrection of the life. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God, who is to come into the world. We too must make a profession of our faith. We too must have the humility of Zacchaeus. Our Lord came to save us sinners. And so we rejoice in celebrating the dedication of this temple, this tabernacle. What's the business of the temple, the dwelling place of God on earth? Sacrifice. Know you not that I must be about my Father's business? After 3 days, Mary and Joseph found Jesus in the temple, teaching the doctors, and so teaching all of us too. What was he teaching them about? About the same thing Our Lady asked him, Son, why hast thou done this to me? Do you not know I must be about my Father's business? What is the Father's business? His passion, death, and resurrection. After 3 days, he rose. Let us then seek to recognize that we too, through baptism, have become temples of God. What was our Lord's first temple on earth? What was his first tabernacle, his first dwelling place? Our Lady. Where he first offered on behalf of us praise and thanks and expiation to the Heavenly Father. And it was through her. This is the great mystery of the Mother of God. Through her, he comes to us. He has through her active cooperation with the Holy Spirit. And it is through her that we go to him. With the active cooperation of the Holy Spirit. Dear brothers and sisters, keep all these thoughts in mind always, especially in moments of distress, moments of weakness, moments of temptation, moments of discouragement, of seeming darkness. Nothing is working right. One thing is always working right for us, and that is the church, not because churchmen are great shakes, but because the founder of the church is still here, And because the profile of the Church is still that of Mary, and she is still close to us, helping us to believe and above all to hope. It is for that sake of hope that she did not go immediately to heaven, and she continues to confirm that hope. And we shall celebrate that hope in a very concrete way when we celebrate the feast of her assumption into heaven, only 2 weeks, as it were, from now. One final thought. Remember, on the vigil of the Assumption is also the feast of St. Maximilian Mary Kolbe. Totally consecrated to Our Lady, he lived that kind. What does it mean? That he would be a priest like Jesus Christ and literally lay down his life for the sake of a father of the family, Mr. Francis Gajonicek. That is a wonderful thing. It happened on the vigil of the Assumption when he was cremated by the Nazis. But it is also significant, it tells us, even in the worst of circumstances in the modern concentration camp, there is no reason for doubting. There is no reason for despairing. Hundreds and hundreds of testimonies given in the process of beatification are witness to this. It was not simply the final gift of life for another. It was the fact that while he was still alive, the saint sustained the faith and the hope of those who were brought into the consecrated precisely to destroy not just their bodies, their faith and their hope, to become once again prisoners of Satan. And it was through Our Lady and through a servant of Our Lady that the devil was frustrated. Remember that always, and you will never be sad if you carry the cross of Christ. You know that it is the guarantee of a final victory. Praise be Jesus and Mary.